brothers and sisters were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in the keeping of this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. These are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, idolatry, and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, and orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And such things, against such things, there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step. A word from the Lord, thanks be to God. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. This I pray. Amen. Amen. And so we've all heard the expression, freedom is not free. And as we come to celebrate freedom over the next week or so, we need to remember this, that your freedom, it comes with a price. And so as we celebrate freedom, we have to remember that it's much more than fireworks, picnics, cookouts, parades, celebrations, and barbecues. Really, what it is a chance for us to remember, a moment for us to pause and reflect on our freedom, the freedom that men and women of previous generations gave their lives and in service to protect. And one of our most underlying freedoms, underlying principles, is that of religious liberty. The freedom to worship, to join any house of worship, and worship the Lord your God as we see fit. The First Amendment to the Constitution of the United States says this: Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of the people to peaceably assemble, and to petition the government for the redress of grievances. This is our first freedom. It's something that the founders sought to protect, and they enshrined it before all others, because they knew its importance. I think that we are seeing that play out in this day and age. But more important, Paul, the Apostle Paul, also understood the importance of this kind of freedom. And so he made a conscious choice on the road to Damascus when he accepted Christ as his Lord and Savior. Then he was guided to a home in Damascus. prolific writer, and he traveled the known world spreading the gospel. Remember, Paul was once the persecutor of Christianity. When he was going up to Damascus, he sought to find Christians to arrest them, to bring them back to Jerusalem to stand trial. And in that moment, all the world world. And Paul was not a soft-spoken man by any stretch of the imagination. He was a guarded, fierce champion for the faith. And he knew that a person had to make a choice. It was a conscious decision for each and every person who chose to follow Christ that they had to make. No one could make it for them. To whom Paul wrote this letter, revels in their freedom, the freedom from the yoke of the law. But Paul reminded them and reminds us that we are not absolved from responsibility, that it rests squarely on their shoulders, and to this day, our shoulders. Paul writes, "For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not give your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love, become slaves to one another." So our freedom is inherent in Christ, because it is the forgiveness of our sin and the they're not under a parent's rule, but there's no one telling them what to do. No one reminding them, get to class, get to work. You have to be responsible. And there are some who rise to the challenge that are guided by the principles their parents instilled in them, and they thrive in that freedom. And others run wild. And they have to learn the hard way, those hard lessons on how to live, how to be responsible, about being in the world and balancing their freedom and responsibility, and balancing the world with sense. Paul uses this. He says, the whole law is summed up in a single commandment. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you're not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, my son, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. And so we have this balancing act. There are things that compete for our time and our attention every single day of our lives. And the voice of Christ is present there. Buzzing in your ears. You have to listen carefully because it is so easily drowned out by the cacophony of the world going on around us. Because we live in a world of instant gratification. If you want something today, you get it today. And you may not always consider the consequences, because pleasure is seductive. It is designed to engage the senses, the smell of it, sight, sound, taste, touch. And I think that there's our physical reaction. And so rather than pleasure and thoughts of it, the Spirit gets neglected in the pursuit of his fleshly desires. Paul is so blunt about this. And I really do love that about him, that he is so clear and so reminded of this. He spells things out in no uncertain terms. He says there are things that work actively against the Spirit. He says, these are so obvious when we set up ourselves, when we slow down and take a look at what's going on around us. It points out so many different things. Fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, deception, faction, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like this. I think all of us, at one point or another in our lives, even if we're not going to admit it to each other, have been guilty of this. And God recognizes what's in our hearts. God recognizes who we are. And so as Christians, we are given a challenge. It takes work for us to embrace the fruit of the Spirit. Because we are constantly tempted by the pleasures of the flesh. And so we have to replace our hatred for something with love. We have to replace fighting with peace. We have to respect our marriage vows, avoiding the temptation of adultery, avoiding domestic violence. My friends, we have to exercise self-control. No binge drinking, no recreational drugs, no excessive behaviors. that we all find ourselves living in. We have to buy things out of need rather than out of want. And we don't always need to get the latest and the greatest in order to be happy. Friends, we have to search for peaceful solutions and not strike back in anger. Paul reminds us what the fruits of the Spirit are, and we need to embrace them as a people of faith. The fruits of the Spirit, according to Paul, are love, joy, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things. These are things that build others up, and they do not tear people down. They do not punish people, and no one is sorry when we embrace the fruits of the Spirit. That's when we know God's love. We build up our neighbor, and we become self-aware as Christians as to what we're doing and why we're doing it. We become aware of the presence of Christ in our midst. When we love, when we give peace and joy and kindness. It's not about ignoring the world and its many delights. After all, God created this world, and in that moment, God said it was good. God wants us to feel good, to know pleasure within restraint, to know contentment, but not overindulgence. We cannot give ourselves over to sin and wantonness, but we have to be content, judicious, and sober-minded. And in all of this, the Holy Spirit is our guide. But we're not bound by the law, but rather we have the freedom of the Spirit. And so that means we exercise self-control, and we use Christ as our model, our guide, and our hope. So the freedom in Christ means that we have a great responsibility. Each one of us has asked Christ to come into our hearts. Each one of us has to recognize the sin that surrounds us and tries to control us. It means that we need to act accordingly, to embrace the Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit, and ignore those things that seek to destroy us and break us down. Also, as we live by the Spirit, we should be guided by the Spirit. So, my friends, that is what we need to do in our faith walk. It is what we need to do as we seek to navigate this topsy-turvy world. We can see all the things that are going on around us, and we despair. So, the one thing we can do is see to ourselves. And what that means is we have to open our hearts, our souls to Christ. We have to make sure that Christ is welcome and that we are not pushing Christ or the Spirit away through our actions. It means we need to hold on and embrace the freedom we have to come and worship God and Christ in a place like this. It means allowing the Lord your God to guide how you worship and to guide when you worship. To cherish the freedom that we have to worship as we see fit. Cherish the freedom to embrace the fruits of the Spirit and apply them to your lives. And embrace giving all that you have, all that you are, to God. Because remember what Jesus said, what is the best commandment? What is the greatest commandment? He said this: you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And the second is like this. You shall love your neighbor and yourself as yourself. That's what we mean by friends. To love God. To love Christ. To love the Spirit. And to love this week, share this story.